estimated magnitude of 7.8. This earthquake killed over 1,600 people and leveled entire cities. The Queen Victoria Hotel collapsed, and the Gonzalez family all rushed out to safety before realizing that 9-year-old Seth was still inside. He rushed back into the rubble, trying to find his son, and miraculously, he found his son alive, and he was able to dig him out and safely get him out of the hotel, out of the rubble. But this earthquake really left the Gonzalez family in a financial mess. To varying degrees from their experience with this earthquake, and they decided that they needed to make a fresh start somewhere new. The Gonzalez family had some extended family in Australia, so this was where they decided to relocate. They moved to the Australian state of New South Wales, and they loved everything about this country. Teddy worked to be able to pass the bar in Australia so he could practice law. After he graduated, he opened his own law firm. His wife worked with him. She was the office manager. By the late 90s, the Gonzalez family had this thriving business. Teddy and Lovia bought some land and began the process of building their dream home. Seth was quiet and he took his schoolwork very seriously. He got straight A's and everyone believed he would eventually become either a doctor or a lawyer. He was also really into music and had dreams of becoming an R&B star. Although his parents were very career-oriented, they felt like Seth's head was just up in the clouds. They pushed Seth to concentrate on his academics, even though he still just loved music. His parents told him he needed an education, like a plan for life. He couldn't just dream of making it big. Seth would go on to join a hip-hop band called Definite Vibes, and they played at nightclubs and hosted dance parties. They were pretty successful, and soon Seth got a $40,000 recording contract from a major music label. So he's not like a huge star, but he's kind of a local celebrity. And because of this, Seth knew he could pretty much date whoever he wanted. He even had a stalker, or maybe more like an obsessed fan, named Daisy Diaz. Daisy had this blog called Daisy's Dedication Page to Seffy. On her blog, it says, quote, "Hi, in case you've stumbled onto here on accident, I'm Daisy Diaz, and I wrote this page for my best friend, Seth. Remember that he's a sweetie and a true friend. Besides being trustworthy, caring, cute, adorable, kind, understanding, he can sing in a way that makes any girl's heart melt. And if you mess with him, you mess with me." So she has this entire blog about Seth, and there's all these pictures of him and song lyrics, and she would even dedicate different songs to Seth. Being smart and talented Joseph was doing amazing in his studies. He was also working part-time in his father's law firm, where he worked as a paralegal, and he also did some IT work. Teddy and Lavia were so proud of their son. He was so hardworking. He was accomplishing so much, and to show him how proud they were, they bought him a green Ford Festiva. They even personalized the license plate. Seth was over the moon with his gift from his parents, and this car, it really kind of became his baby. In the meantime, Claudine was also doing extremely well with her schoolwork. While Seth was really, really quiet, Claudine was very much the opposite of her brother. She was outgoing, she was very personable. She is described as being very animated. She's kind of always chatting with whoever was around. She was athletic, she loved to cook, and she was planning on becoming a teacher. So while Claudine and Seth were definitely very different, because of the high expectations from their parents that were kind of put on them, this created some, like, major sibling rivalry. While the two were often arguing, it is said that they never took the arguing too far. It was just common, like, sibling arguments. The Gonzalez parents were also very, very strict. They raised their children in the Catholic Church, so they were always making sure that these arguments between their kids never got out of hand. You could still see a glimpse in the sweet relationship between the siblings, though, like when Claudine began dating a 19-year-old boy named Chris. Seth became very protective of his sister. While the two Gonzalez kids had a pretty easy life, they were provided for, they lived in this beautiful new home, and they had many opportunities. They also had parents who very heavily moderated their lives. When Claudine began dating Chris, the Gonzalez's became even more strict with her, and she really pushed back. She was a very strong-willed girl. She would, like, sneak out of the house to see her boyfriend. She was also very different from Seth as far as her academics went. It was not the most important thing to her. Her social life definitely took a front seat to academics. And I think Teddy and Lavina, I mean, I think they meant well, but they were basically trying to micromanage these two teenagers' lives. And when Claudine began to push back, they were like, you know what, you're spending too much time with your friends. And they sent her away to Melbourne to live with some family members so she could concentrate on her schooling without any distractions. By 2001, Teddy was busy mentoring his son in his law practice. He was so proud of the way that he was, like, joining the practice, and he knew one day he would take over the family company. In July, Claudine came home to visit her family. There was, like, a school break, and also her 18th birthday was coming up, and this was something she could not stop 6 p.m. when Emily arrived at her sister's house, and she was kind of surprised because it didn't look like anyone was home. The house was dark. There were no lights on. It just seemed like the home was empty. The garage door was closed, so she couldn't tell if her sister's car was parked in it or not, but Seth's green car was parked outside. So, Emily is sitting in front of her sister's house for a minute, and she saw something quickly move by one of the downstairs windows. So she's like, oh, I guess someone is home. Now, it had been raining all day long, and Emily was glad that at this time, it was 6 o'clock, there had been kind of a break in the weather. So they get up out of the car and they walk to the front door. And when she gets up close, she sees there's light coming from the window. It looked like a light in the kitchen was on, and the kitchen was in the rear of the home, so she hadn't seen that light from her car. Emily rang the bell several times, but no one answered. She kind of listened to see if she could hear anything, any movement, and she couldn't. And this was eerie because the family had several small dogs. I think they had like 5 or 6 dogs that were usually barking as soon as someone was at the door. Emily tried to look through a window by the door, which had like frosted glass, and she jumped back when she saw the figure of like an upright figure, was how she described it, wearing a long coat and a baseball hat. She thought she saw it move, but because of the dim light and the frosted glass, she wasn't sure. It almost looked like a shadow. The more that Emily looked, the more she decided that what she was seeing was not a person, but it was the coat stand in her sister's entryway, and it must have a coat on it and a hat. So she's not really sure what to think. She decides to go to the back of the home to see if any doors were unlocked that she could enter through. She kind of felt like something was off, but as she was walking to the back of the home, she got this distinct feeling that she should not try to get in the house. She just needed to stop. She decided to listen. she said. She'd been trying to get a hold of Claudine all night, but the line, like the landline to the family's home, had been busy for hours. Seth pulled out his phone and tried to call home, and he also got a busy signal. He was worried, though. I guess the family had dial-up internet, which meant that when someone was online, he would get a busy signal in the landline. After eating dinner, Seth and his friend headed to a nearby arcade. They stayed there till around 11 p.m. playing video games. Seth dropped Sam off at his house before heading home. At 11:48 p.m., a New South Wales emergency line got a call from a frantic Seth, yelling hysterically that his parents had been shot and they were bleeding on the floor. Seth then ran to his neighbors, yelling, "Help, help, my father has been killed." All of these neighbors came running out of their houses after hearing Seth's cries, and they just found him crying hysterically. Almost incoherently, but he kept saying over and over that his father had been shot dead. One of the neighbors made another 000 call to get help while Seth paced the street in front of his home before suddenly collapsing. The neighbors began trying to comfort Seth, but they weren't really sure what to do. And then he suddenly jumped up and he was like, "I know how to do CPR." And he rushed back inside the home. They followed Seth into the house, but no one was prepared for the scene that they were stumbling into. 46-year-old Teddy was lying on his back on a white rug near the front door. Blood was pooling all around him. Seth rushed over and began, I guess, trying to do CPR. It was very apparent to everyone that the large wounds in Teddy's chest had been fatal. Seth then ran into another room, the dining room, and this was where there was another body laying on the floor near a coffee table. It was 43-year-old Livia, and her body was riddled with wounds. Seth rushed back and forth between his parents, sobbing hysterically. The neighbors knew they needed to get Seth out of the house, and I'm not really sure at this point if they were trying to preserve the crime scene at all, or if they were just worried that maybe the killer was still in there, but they all, like, left the home. Soon, the street was filled with police officers and paramedics. I guess there were still some concerns that the killer was inside of the home, so paramedics were not allowed in right away. But after a few minutes, armed officers would escort medics into the home. Inside the home on the main floor, Teddy and Livia were pronounced dead. And then police made their way up the stairs trying to clear the home. And this was when they discovered the body of Claudine curled up in fetal position inside her bedroom. Seth sat in a state of shock while police began to process the scene. He was just kind of hunched over, rocking back and forth. His dad's body on the floor, and misidentified the wounds as bullet wounds. Then he called for police and medical help, and he ran upstairs to attend to his sister's wounds. He said while he was upstairs, he heard something, and he ran downstairs and saw a figure running away, or just like kind of a shadowy figure. He wasn't sure if it was just one person or two, because it was so dark. He wasn't sure if he could just see like the shadow from the one person. Police immediately began looking into the family to try and find a motive for these killings. As they looked into Teddy's history, they found that he had been looked into in the 90s by the Department of Immigration because he allegedly was helping immigrants lie on their documents. Government officials charged Teddy with four counts of forgery, and I guess two of these counts got dropped, but he did go to court and he was cleared of all of these charges. However, Teddy had a lot of unhappy clients who accused him of taking all of their money, even though their visas were never like accepted, or their visas had been denied. In 2001, Teddy was overheard on the phone at work yelling at someone, like screaming at someone. When a coworker asked what was going on, he said he was trying to sell one of his properties in the Philippines, and the deal had just kind of gone south, but didn't elaborate. So there was some evidence to suggest that Teddy may have a few enemies out there. 3 days after the murders, Seth offered a $100,000 reward for any information leading to an arrest in the case. He spoke with the media about his grief of losing his entire family. That same day, he went and met with his father's accountant and asked about gaining access to his inheritance, which was estimated at about $2.7 million. On July 20th, 2001, a joint funeral was held for the deceased Gonzalez family members. Seth spoke about how his father was going to tell him the origin of his unique name on his 21st birthday, but how his father had essentially taken that secret to the grave. He said, quote, "I will never find out the meaning of my name because it was taken away along with my father, and that part of me will always be incomplete," end quote. Seth finishes his remarks and then kind of bursts into this a cappella rendition of One Sweet Day by Mariah Carey and Boyz II Men, and everyone at the funeral felt like this was strange. It kind of made everyone uncomfortable to watch. But it wasn't just people at the funeral who had been noticing Seth's odd behavior since the murders. Police had also taken notice. In fact, unbeknownst to Seth, he was the main person of interest in the murders, like from the minute police arrived on scene. See, while Seth had been sobbing and kind of acting the part, he wasn't crying real tears, like his face was dry. Alice's questions seemed well thought out and rehearsed, not those of like a frantic family member who was just found his family killed. He claimed that he did CPR on his parents, but there was barely any blood found on him. And given the state of the victim's bodies, it was unlikely he had attempted CPR. In fact, police pointed this out to Seth, and he said the rain must have washed all the blood away. A detective also noticed some blue staining on Seth's sleeve, just like a little bit right here, which matched the blue spray paint used to leave the racially charged message in the kitchen. A shoebox was found in Seth's closet that had originally contained a pair of size 7 running shoes. These shoes were nowhere to be found at the crime scene, but after some investigation, police realized they were a perfect match to the bloody footprints found throughout the home. Seth said he had never owned that pair of shoes. His dad had bought them to send to like a relative, and Seth had just kept the box to keep stuff in. CCTV footage did confirm Seth's alibi that he had gone to dinner with Sam and then an arcade between 11 and 4. But these murders had taken place between 4 and 7, and Seth didn't really have an alibi during this crucial time. A witness came forward to tell police that he had stopped at the Gonzalez home around 4:30 on the day of the murders to drop off some documents for Teddy, and he, like, the plan had been to just drop them through a mail slot, but he did recall seeing a green Ford Festiva parked out front while he was at the home. And this wasn't the only person who had seen Seth's car at his family's home during the time of the murders. Remember, Emily, Seth's aunt, had also been there at 6 p.m. and she remembers seeing Seth's car. She had thought someone was in the home because there was some movement, but no one had answered. Seth's statement had said he had also briefly went to his home at 6 p.m. He said it was raining so hard that he didn't get out of his car. He instead went to drive to find his friend's house, but he didn't have the address and never found it. If you'll remember, Emily's statement to police said she remembered being grateful that at 6 o'clock, when she was at the home, there had been a break in the weather. And so Seth's statement is really conflicting with Emily's statement, because he's saying he pulled up at 6 o'clock and it was pouring rain. Emily also remembers seeing Seth's car, but told police no one was inside it. Like, he wasn't pulled up sitting in his car when she pulled up. Police knew Seth was lying, but they had no idea the extent of his lies over the years. He lied to people about owning properties abroad, saying he often flew to New York on business. He claimed to be the manager of a boy band and a music agent and a manager for a modeling agency. In fact, in the past, he had even told all of his friends that he had been diagnosed with cancer, and then went through this whole thing about how he was going through treatment before eventually announcing that he had beat police discovered that he had actually been falsifying university documents to make it look like he was doing well, when in fact he had failed every single class for the semester. So I guess this information was exposed. Someone told Teddy and Livia this right before their deaths, and this caused a major rift between Seth and his parents. They were threatening to disinherit him. Seth really seemed to benefit the most from his parents' death, and with Claudine out of the way, he was the sole heir to the estate. Seth was at a coffee shop when this random guy was like, "Hey, I like your outfit," or whatever. And Seth was super flattered, and the two began talking, and this guy told Seth that he was actually in a gang. And Seth lied and told this guy that he was also in a gang. He called it the White Dragons Asian, which was like a completely made-up gang that's not even a gang. Over the next few weeks, Seth and this man became really good friends. This guy knew of Seth's circumstances, and he's like, "Hey, I've got a buddy who's in prison, and he is dying, and he'll take, the rap for any murders. He'll confess to it." So, basically, Seth ended up not going through with this, but not before he drew a map of the inside of the Gonzalez home with, like, little X's where each of the bodies had been found, and he even wrote down the time of death for each person, and this was information that had been withheld from the public by police. For this exact reason, they knew there were hours between these deaths, but at the time, no one else did. The media was kind of suspecting someone went in, killed three people, and was out within a matter of minutes. What Seth didn't know was his new gang friend was actually an undercover police officer. So while they did have Seth knowing information that only the killer would know, he stopped short of confessing to the murders. Police had taken Seth's personal computer into evidence, and they found that he had been searching for ways to poison people. He actually ordered some extremely poisonous seeds online, and they had been delivered in early July. Police believed that Lovia's food poisoning had actually been her son trying to poison her, and she had gotten really sick. She had ended up in the hospital for a night or two. Now, remember Daisy Diaz, the fangirl who had the blog dedicated to Seth? Well, police questioned Seth about her, and he said that she had died during the 9/11 attacks in America. But as it would turn out, Daisy Diaz did not exist. He had made up this entire blog to basically boast about himself. In July of 2001, Seth told his extended family members that he had been diagnosed with a brain tumor, and he asked several of them for large sums of money to pay for this surgery he needed. They all refused to give him money and instead told police about the requests. Because of the investigation into the murders, the estate was tied up and he could not access any money. Although he Seth was made aware, the police believed he was the killer. Police by this point had tapped his phone. They were listening to everything, and one day they overheard a phone call between Seth and a friend, and he was saying that on the night of the murder, he was actually with a sex worker, so he had lied about his alibi. After this call, police confronted Seth about his alibi, and he said that he had not ever gone looking for his friend's new house on the night of the murders. He had actually gone to visit a sex worker, but he had lied because he was embarrassed. Seth said that his dad's office Seth said that he was at his dad's office until 4 p.m. Then he went home and parked his car out front and walked to a gas station where he called a cab to pick him up to take him to a brothel. He said his car stood out. It had a personal license plate, and he was worried that if anyone drove by this brothel, they would immediately know he was in it. He said after he got another taxi and went home, immediately got in his car and went to meet Sam without ever entering the home. Police knew that Seth had recently been contacting a lot of different brothels in the area. They also noticed he was having some like online communications with an unknown man. So they tracked down this man, and he ended up being a local taxi driver. Seth had approached him and offered him $50 to write a statement saying he had picked him up and dropped him off at a brothel on the night of the murders. By early April, police had spoken with the sex worker who Seth claimed he had been with the night of the murders. She told police not only was she not with Seth that night, she wasn't even working at the brothel that night, but he had been harassing her and texting her nonstop, offering to pay her to say they had been together. In the meantime, Seth is just scrambling, like making up all of these stories, trying to cover his tracks. So on May 30th, he calls police and says that his home, he was living in an apartment, had been broken into, and someone was leaving him threatening emails, or I think threatening notes at his home, saying that he needed to confess to the murders, even though he didn't do it, or he would be killed. But police do not believe this at all. On June 16th, police executed a search warrant on Seth's apartment, and they also arrested him for 3 counts of murder. Seth's fingerprints were taken, and they were added into the police's database, which was protocol, and they immediately get a flag, like a match to an unidentified set of fingerprints that had been found on an envelope. So there had been a letter sent to a food manufacturer on July 2nd, 2001. This threatening letter claimed that the products of this company that produced food were tainted with poison. The letter said, quote, "Your products have been poisoned, but by now they are on supermarket shelves. This is what you get for treating your employees like garbage. Good luck finding the infected cans before someone dies. Go to hell." End quote. this letter to have it kind of on file so that when his entire family ended up dead from poison, this would kind of go along with the narrative he was trying to create. So after this, along with his murder charges, he was charged with threatening product contamination. Seth's bail was rejected after his grandmother and aunt both spoke in court about how they feared for their lives. Seth was considered a flight risk and his bail was denied. 2 months later, Seth launched an application to gain access to his parents' estate so that he could fund his defense. But this was denied. A trial began in April of 2004. The prosecution had a lot of evidence to show premeditation. Seth had been carefully planning these murders for months. They maintained that he had murdered his parents because he had failed his classes and he didn't want to get his car taken away. He also killed his sister, although the reason why came out in court and it was much more personal. See, his sister Claudine had been the one to find out that her brother had actually failed out of college and had been forging documents to make it look like he was still enrolled. So she went to the parents and told on Seth. On May 20th, 2004, Seth was found guilty of killing Teddy, Lavina, and Claudine. Seth looked visibly shaken when he heard the verdict. I do not think he thought he would, be found guilty. Outside the court, his aunt spoke to the press and she talked about how they had just lost another member of their family. And while they are glad that justice was served, they're sad that it ended up being Seth. During sentencing, victim impact statements were read by Seth's extended family. His grandmother wrote in part, quote, "To this day, I am struggling to cope with the pain and trauma that has happened. I miss all of them every day," end quote. Doctors were brought in to try to determine if Seth maybe had some undiagnosed mental disorder that had contributed to the crimes, but they concluded that there was just what they had was insufficient evidence to make a diagnosis. The possibility that Seth had repressed traumatic stress after being trapped in the rubble from the earthquake was also denied. During his sentencing, Seth never expressed regret for his actions. In fact, he just made a point to show how much pain he was in. He maintained he was innocent, and when they gave him a chance to speak, he actually turned to his grandmother and said, quote, "If you don't think I am in pain, you're wrong. Whatever pain you're feeling, I'm feeling much worse than you. I am not going to plead guilty to something I didn't do just to make people happy," end quote. On September 18th, 2004, Seth was sentenced to 3 concurrent life sentences without the possibility of parole. After the sentencing, his aunt Emily said, quote, "It's actually a sad day because because we love Seth very much. But I'm glad it's over. We will always love him.